Can you put your hands together and give God praise? Come on, let's bless him in this place. He's the name above all names, Jesus. Come on, let's bless him like we know him. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. His name is Elohim. Come on, El Shaddai. And we magnify your holy name in this your house. And we thank you, God, for inviting us in, for loving us, for looking beyond our faults and seeing our needs. So we give you praise and glory and honor. Come on, one more time. Come on, Messiah, one more time. Come on, just get comfortable with it. Come on, get comfortable with it. David said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. That means when I'm driving, when I'm at my job, when I'm giving my little baby a bath, I will bless the Lord at all times. So surely when we're in God's house, we ought to have some praise up in here. Amen. Come on, one more time. Let's come on. Just get comfortable with it. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Come on. Corporate praise. Worship him. And so, scripture says that God literally inhabits praise. And as you begin to unpack that word inhabit, dwells in our praise, it means that he abodes in our praise. It's where he's most comfortable. That when we praise him, that's when God is most comfortable to be himself. Amen? It has the meaning of how you're comfortable in your own home, like you're not comfortable in anybody else's home. When I'm in my own home, I can, you know, just wear the clothes I want to wear that I'm comfortable in. I can wear those socks with a hole in them because that's what I really like to wear. And I'm able to really be myself. So when we're able to praise God together, God is able to be himself. Now let me tell you who God is when he's just himself. He does miracles. He brings salvation. He speaks words. So as we begin to praise him together, God literally is moving in praise. Praise is not just an exercise in praising God. Sure, that's true. But it's also inviting God to do miracles in our life. So once again, come on, let's put our hands together. Come on. Clap your hands. Shout to God. We bless you, God, and we magnify your name. You're worthy of the praise. We thank you for waking us up this morning. Thank you for starting us on our way. Come on. Come on. Let's praise him. Come on, y'all. One more time. Well, good Lord's Day to you, Messiah Community Church. Thank you so much for receiving me today. And thank God for your pastor, Pastor Rod Harrison, amen, and Lady Sherry. Let's put our hands together and thank God for a mighty man of God. Man, what a wonderful work. Pastor Harrison is a dear friend, and I just want to let y'all know the last time Pastor Harrison came, we had not won a championship, amen, but now we've won a championship in Cleveland. Glory to God. We lost LeBron James, but we thank God for the time he was there. We thank God for June 2016. And I want to tell y'all, with me sharing the same last name as LeBron James, I checked into it to see if I was related to him in any kind of way. Ancestry.com, through a cousin, through a dog, something, and didn't find anything, man. I was hopeful, but I wasn't. My name is Kevin James. I am a follower, a passionate follower of Jesus Christ. I am the husband of Tanya James, and I am the father of Christopher, Taylor, and Lauren. And I also have the honor of being the pastor of New Community Bible Fellowship. And I bring you greetings from New Community Bible Fellowship in Cleveland, Ohio. Amen. So glad to be with you. God's doing wonderful things in your church and through you all, and as he's using you to transform lives and impact this community for the glory of God. So we bless the Lord. I've been getting the chance to meet with Pastor Jeffers and also Brother Bass and just learn about your ministry and all the wonderful things that are going on here. While you're standing, if you have a Bible, turn to Genesis 32 for the reading of God's word. If you don't have a Bible, we're going to put these scriptures on the screen. I like the idea of corporate reading the scripture together as we launch into the word of God. And so we're going to read Genesis 32 verses 24 through 26 loud and with strength, the public reading of God's word together. And we're going to enjoy reading God's word. Are you ready? Genesis 32, 24. Then Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Now when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. Verse 26, and he said, let me go, for the day breaks. But he said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. Today I want to take a little time and talk to you about the fact that God is fighting for you. God is fighting for you. Let's bow together. We do love your name, and we do bless and praise your name, King Jesus. We thank you so much for loving us, for looking beyond our faults and seeing our needs. We thank you for your redemptive grace, your atonement, your love that caused you some 2,000 years ago to allow yourself to be crucified, to die for our sins, and then to raise from the dead some 3 days later with all power and glory. In this moment, we ask you to open our hearts to hear everything that you want to say to us. May this be a sacred moment, a defining moment, a God moment in our lives. Help us never to waste an opportunity when we come together as your people, dear God, to worship and to receive your word and to encourage one another. So, Father, help us not to leave out of here the same way in which we came. And I'm praying for those who are carrying heavy burdens and who are struggling through. I'm praying your grace and your mercy. I'm praying you would comfort. I'm praying you would speak wisdom. I pray you would speak life, dear God. And I pray you would touch us for your glory. We'll be careful to give you all the praise, glory, and honor, for it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Can we shout together real loud, amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. I want to talk to you about that God is fighting for you, amen? How many of you know that God is a warrior? He is the Lord God, strong and mighty. The psalmist says he's the Lord God who's mighty in battle, and he fights for you and me. In fact, 2,000 years ago, Jesus fought for us when he died for us on the cross, amen, and rose from the grave. When he rose from the grave, he fought for us, and he got victory over death, hell, and the grave. Jesus is fighting for you. God is fighting for you. God told Jehoshaphat, and this is just one of many places throughout Scripture, but God told Jehoshaphat, he said, hey, listen, the battle is not yours, Jehoshaphat. If you praise me, I will do the fighting for you. God fights for us. Did you know that God will not only fight principalities and powers and the devil, but God will even fight other people for us? Because sometimes people is where the enemy shows up. Amen. Think about that. Even with Peter, who was dedicated to Jesus, who loved Jesus, but there was a time at one point where Jesus had to look Peter in the eyes and say, get behind me, Satan. Because Satan was trying to use Peter as Satan sometimes uses people, but God says he will fight for us. Now, as much as God will fight the devil for you and for me, and much as God will fight death, hell, and the grave, as much as God will fight demons and principalities, and as much as God will fight people for us, here's the real aha moment of this message, that God will even fight you for you. God will even fight you for you. Jacob found himself in a space where God was not fighting somebody else for Jacob. No, God was fighting Jacob for Jacob's sake. Because if we're honest, sometimes my worst enemy, maybe it's just me, my worst enemy sometimes is myself. Sometimes it's not about God protect me from my enemy. Sometimes it's about God protect me from myself. Come on, somebody help me preach it. Jacob has spent most of his life running from God, holding back from God. And God showed up and he literally wrestled with Jacob, gave him a new name. And by the way, one of the things we're going to learn here today is that God has a name for you. He has your real name for you. Remember Mufasa and Lion King, and Rafiki had to show up and say, you don't even know who you are. Sometimes we don't even know who we are. And I'm not talking about the name that you have on your driver's license. I'm not talking about the name that you have on your birth certificate. I'm talking about who you really think you are and what you've been really called to do by God himself. See, when God changes our names, it's not because something sounds better. It's not because Rock sounds better than Dwayne Johnson, okay? It's not because P. Diddy sounds better than Puff Daddy. No, when God changes our name, he changes our name to reveal our real identity, our real purpose and direction for life. When God changes your name, he changes your heart. See, sometimes we go through some things and we get labeled by it. And what should have been an experience or what should have been a season ends up becoming something that we define ourselves by for the rest of our lives. That's not God's will for us, but sometimes we get trapped in a bad moment, and because of that moment, we come out with a label. Divorcee. We come out with a label. Unemployable. Fired. We come out with a label. A label, quitter. We come out with a label, dropout. We come out with a label, addict. We come out with a label, liar. We come out with a label, I've got the label, I just mess up everything. Whatever it is, the enemy will put a label on you and try and make it seem like that's who you are for the rest of your life. And because of that, we can get off from our purpose. And that's exactly what happened to Jacob. But I want to tell you that God removes the false labels and replaces them with his true purpose for us. So today, what I want us to do is to try to find out our true definition of who we really are and learn to surrender to God so that we can receive all the blessings that God has for us. Because when we spend a lifetime fighting with God, as Jacob had been doing, we end up with a lifetime of frustration, misery, and falling short. Let me say that again. When we spend a lifetime fighting with God, we end up with a lifetime of frustration, misery, and falling short. We cannot fight with God, even though we try. Amen? Whenever we decide to do that, we're going to come out on the short end of that stick, and sooner or later, because of God's love, he's going to reach down. He's going to just give us a limp to help us along the way. Because sometimes God has to give us a limp to help us to walk right. Amen? God has to give us a limp so we can walk straight into all the things that God wants to give us. Because whenever we fight with God, we'll end up with a lifetime of misery, frustration, and falling short. I've seen this over and over. I've seen this in my own life. I remember in a season that our church was growing. It was explosive growth. Things were going crazy. It was so exciting. The church grew literally over a period of 2 years from about 400 people to 2,500 people. And it was just amazing. But here was the problem. I was focusing more on the growth than I should have been focusing on leadership. And God was speaking to me. God was saying, slow down. God was saying, organize this thing. This is like one of those wild chariots that's out of control. But I was focused on the growth. I was seduced by the growth, and I wasn't focusing on leadership. And as a result, God allowed us to go through a breaking because God would give you a limp. I've seen this happen as a pastor. I've been pastoring for over 20 years. I've seen this happen more times than I'd like to admit with members of our church where I've counseled them. I remember a situation that happened over a decade ago where I counseled this woman. And this is one of many examples of this. I counseled this woman, do not marry that guy. And I told the guy, they were both in church. He was a new Christian. I said, man, she shouldn't marry you. I counseled them and I loved them, but I told them this is not the time. Don't marry them. He's a new believer. There are a lot of issues he's still coming out of. You guys aren't ready as you think. And they got so mad and they got so offended and they didn't see the love. They just saw me over-controlling them the way they put it, and they left the church. And I ran into that woman in a grocery store about 8 years later, and here was the theme of her message to me as we stood in the aisle. Pastor, you were right. We're divorced now. And there's a trail of pain because I went down that road. See, what God will do is if we wrestle with God, we'll look up and we'll have a lifetime of frustration, misery, and falling short. Jacob had been a hustler most of his life, a fast talker, smooth tongue brother, had a big ego, a guy who wanted to be in control of everything, have things go his way, thought he could negotiate his way out of anything, talk his way out of anything. So even when he was born, he was born with his twin Esau because he was a twin. From the very beginning, he was born trying to get over. The word Jacob, Yaakov, in the Hebrew means grabber. It means take advantage of. And when he was born, his brother Esau, his twin brother, who was older than him because Esau came out first. But as they pulled Esau out and they got Esau out, they finally got all the baby out. As Esau's last foot came out, Jacob was holding on to Esau's foot. Here's Jacob's hand coming out. He's just a grabber. From the very day he was born, he was trying to grab and take things that he shouldn't have taken. He not only grabbed his brother's heel at birth, but he also ended up later grabbing Esau's birthright. And then, as if that wasn't enough, the final straw was when he connived his father and brother in order to steal the blessing. Now, the blessing is supposed to go to the oldest son, Esau. The blessing is given by the dying father to the oldest son, and there's so much wrapped up in that blessing, but Esau did not get the blessing because of Jacob's trickery. Guess who got the blessing? Jacob got the blessing. And it was because of that last dirty move that Esau vowed to kill Jacob. And Jacob had to flee for his life. And so Jacob has spent the last 20 years in exile, running from his brother. And finally now, his brother is about to catch up with him. Esau is about a day's journey from where Jacob is. Esau has 400 fighting men with him. Esau is rapidly moving in, getting closer and closer to Jacob. The very thing that Jacob had been running from because Esau had vowed to kill him was about to take him. And so Jacob, in preparation for his brother, he sends away all of his family, sends away all of his servants. He didn't want anybody else to get hurt. And he's left alone, waiting there for Esau. But the last night, before Esau shows up, a mysterious figure shows up. And all throughout the night, this mysterious figure fights with Jacob. There is, in the moonlight silhouette, two men wrestling, fighting, tussling, scuffling, dust being thrown up. Jacob had been wrestling with God his whole life. He had never completely surrendered, but tonight all that would change. God would change his name from Jacob to Israel because God wrestled with him. Now here's my question to you as we get into this. Have you been wrestling with God about something? We're going to find out that when we wrestle with God, a lot of times we do it in secret, so other people may not know we've been wrestling. Have you been wrestling with God about something he wants you to do? Something he wants you to be? And if you have, I've got some counsel for you. It's not sophisticated. It's not complicated. It's real simple. If you've been wrestling with God, don't do that no more, okay? Just stop doing that, because the truth of the matter is, and I want us to put this on the screen. Here's our truth for today. God will provide a successful life as I live a surrendered life to him. And the more we can surrender to God, the more success we will have in life. And the more we fight God, the more we will end up with frustration, misery, and fallout. That's why God told Joshua, remember? Joshua chapter 1 and verse 8, I bet some of y'all can quote that with me. He said, "This book of the law should not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything, not just some things, everything written in it." He says, then, so understand the promise is predicated on us being obedient. Then you will have success. There's the word success. We all want success. Then your ways will be prosperous, as we're careful to do everything written in the word of God. Why? Because God will provide a successful life as I live a surrendered life to him. Here's what we learn from Jacob. The first thing we learn is that when God fights for us, he brings us to a place of solitude. Somebody say solitude. Yeah, he brings us to a place of solitude. Verse 24, Genesis 32, I hope you have your Bibles open in your lap. It says that while Jacob was alone, that a man met him in his place of solitude. A man met him there. Now, this was no ordinary man, and actually this was God himself. What theologians call a theophany. We're going to do a little Bible study here to understand this passage. A theophany is an appearance of God where God will reveal himself to people. And when he does this, it may be in the form of a man. He may reveal himself in the form of an angel. He may reveal himself in the form of a burning bush, Moses. But God himself shows up in Jacob's solitude. And we know it's God because afterwards, if you look at verse 30, Jacob literally says, "I just saw God face to face and I'm still alive. God spared my life. God did not kill me." That's a big deal. Not only that, this was the angel of the Lord. We learned this as you cross-reference and study Hosea chapter 12. This was the angel of the Lord. And whenever you see the angel of the Lord showing up, it's not only God, but it's more specifically Jesus Christ himself appearing, what they call the pre-incarnate Christ. So Jacob is wrestling with the Lord Jesus himself, the second person of the triune God here. Jacob's wrestling with him, with Jesus. I wonder if there's anybody here who's been wrestling with Jesus, fighting with Jesus. We live in a very sophisticated time. There's a lot of different philosophies, a lot of different religions, a lot of different thoughts, a lot of different views, and you may be wrestling with Jesus when he says, "I am the way, the truth, and the light." Jesus says, "Come to me." Is there anybody here who's resisting Jesus today? See, we can show all the right things in public, but we can still be resisting Jesus in our heart. And God had really been wrestling with Jacob his whole life because God wrestles with us in secret. I said God wrestles with us in secret. And God may have told you a long time ago that he loved you, he died for you, he wants you to fully come to him, but you did a Jacob. He said go right and you went left. You did a Jonah. And God says no more holding back. I love you. And the reason I'm coming after you, the reason I'm wrestling with you, the reason I'm fighting you for you is because I love you. And I understand you. I get you better than you get yourself. And because of that wrestling.